فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
But my one doesn't have that problem because I didn't use the word يحتمل. I said يلزمه. Either you have to say it's truthful or it's a lie. Which one are you going to say about Allah's Quran? Truthful, خلاص. Simple. Are you with me? But when you say يحتمل, it's a possibility, it can take each one, then you're opening possibility for the Quran. Then you have to bring لذاته. Are you with me, brothers? This is ta'rif, which is muhaqqaq. It's a قول يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب. Allah's kalam, what do we say? يلزمه الصدق ولا يلزمه الكذب. This speech you just said, يلزمه الصدق. That statement you said before, لكن يلزمه الكذب. خلاص, no problem. Are you with me, brothers? هذا أوضح. It's better. إنشاء, on the other hand, is قول لا يلزمه الصدق أو الكذب. إنشاء means قول, a speech لا يلزمه الصدق. It doesn't have to be truth or it doesn't have to be a lie. Because it's an amr or it's a nahi or whatnot. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? This definition that we chose is the definition chosen by Ibn Shatt al-Maliki rahimahullah. Ibn Shatt al-Maliki in his Mukhtasar, which he done for the Kitab al-Furu'. In which he done for the Kitab al-Furu' by Qarafi. He summarized it. He summarized the Kitab al-Furu' by Imam al-Shatibi. Imam al-Qarafi, sorry. He called it Mukhtasar. Mukhtasar al-Furu'. He's the one who done tahqiq of this definition. It's very good. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention to that. We finished the second type. So what does, which one does Amr and Nahi enter? Yeah? Insha. Are you with me, brothers? That's where it enters. What about Tamannin wa Ardin wa Qasam? Yeah, all of those? All of those enter Insha. Khabar, on the other hand, is what? It's just information that's given to you. Are we all together, brothers and sisters? Now we're going to move on to the third type of categorization of speech that the author mentioned, which is أَقْسَامُ الْكَلَامِ بِاعْتِبَارِ إِسْتِعْمَالِهِ, in terms of its usage. And in terms of its usage, the author categorized it into two things. The first one is إِلَى حَقِيقَةٍ وَمَجَازٍ. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? حقيقة المجاز. حقيقة المجاز, what does it mean? The author is going to define it. حقيقة means ما بقي في الاستعمال على موضوعه. حقيقة means something that is left in its usage in which it was placed for. When the Arabs came, they placed this word for a meaning. When they came, they said, الأسد is a حيوان مفترس. It's an animal that has claws, it has serious teeth, it's got a mane, huh? Is it called mane? It's the king of the jungle, it moves with its fore. This is what they called a lion, Asad. That's its حقيقي meaning, that's its real meaning. If I take it from what the Arabs placed the word Asad from, and I give it to somebody who's courageous and brave, and I say, you're an asad, I have moved this word from its originally placed meaning. Are you with me? The person who I used it for by saying to him, you are a lion, is called majaz. The reason why it's called majaz is because this is not what it was placed for. But there's a reason why I've given it to him. Are you with me, brothers? Is because لشبه بينهما, there's something they share together that they resemble each other in. What is it that they resemble each other in? The lion is a what? It's brave, شجاعة. And this person the wajhu shabah here is what? And this person here is what? He's brave. Does that make sense, brothers? So I borrowed the term asad from the asad. Somebody comes now to you. They meet you and they say, Salaam alaikum. Akhi, guess what? I saw a lion. Which of the two meanings will come to your head first? A lion, a gorilla. Did somebody say gorilla? Yeah. The thing that you would think of is a what? It's an actual lion, right? Unless he puts in the context something that diverts it from its original usage. Like for example, if he says, Wallahi, I shake the lion's head today, man. Now we know. The word shaked, we know this is something, yeah? Yeah. We know this is not normal. No one can shake a lion's head. A lion will stick his palm out for you. Sah? Are you with me, brothers? This is called qarina. It's called a what? Qarina. For example, what does the word bahar mean in the Arabic language? Sea, right? I say to you today, ra'aytu bahran yakhtub. I saw a sea giving khutbah today. Are you with me, brothers? What is the qarina here? What's the qarina that diverted from its original usage? Huh? Yakhtub. Yakhtub is a qarina. Are you with me, brothers? Also, why did I choose to give this person giving the khutbah bahar? What was the what's the wajhu shabah? What is it that they have in common, both of them? Does the ocean have knowledge? The wajhu shabah is weak here. Al kathra wal ittisa', vastness. That's it. The sea is vast. This person is vast in something. Most likely, it looks like knowledge now because he's saying khutbah. So he's trying to say his knowledge is vast. That's the wajhu shabah. You always try to have. What about if I change the table and I compare the lion to the person? I take a characteristics of this person and I place it in the lion. This is a form of balagha that the Arabs use. Before it was being borrowed from the lion to the person, now the person is giving some characteristics of his to the lion. Even though that characteristics is more stronger in the lion than it is in the person. This is something you won't find when you translate in English. Sah? So a book like Al-Jawhar al-Maknoon, if you study it, you'll benefit all of that from it. That's why Haqiqa and Majaz is studied and is spoken about in Balagha. Is it not? It's spoken about in Balagha. Also, the Sheikh trying to give, he gave a second definition. He said, waqila. This is sighatu tamrid. Some said, when ulama generally mention a definition, and then after that they say qila, they mean that they are not of the second opinion. It's just trying to let you know that there is that definition out there. But he's more inclined to the first definition. Waqila, it's also said, mastu'mila fi mastuliha alayhi min al-mukhatabati. Also, it means mastu'mila, that which is used. Fi mastuliha, in that which is being agreed. The word istilah, generally people don't know what it means. Istilah means when a group of people come together and they agree on usage in something in a way. Are you with me, brothers? We come together and we say to each other, listen, from today onwards, when we use the word mobile, me and you, we mean the restaurant that we were at last night. That's istilah between me and him now. We agreed upon the usage of this word to mean this to us. The word can have a linguistic meaning or lexical meaning, or it could mean something else in somewhere else. But when me and you use it, it's the real deal. It's the place we munched up yesterday. So it's called mobile, okay? This is istilah, according to us. Every field, the people of that field, they have istilah. They use a word amongst themselves to mean something. You can't use another usage of another science for this science. This is jawr. It's transgression. What are you doing here? We didn't make this word in this definition. Fasis means this. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? Like, for example, the word sahih in mustalah al-hadith, what does it mean? هو ما اتصل اسناده ولم يشد او يعل يرويه عدل ضابط عن مثله معتمد في ضبطه ونقله. That's what you say, right? But what about when you come to sahih in sarf? Huh? And what about when you come to sahih in usul al-fiqh? ما يعتد به. It's what you... Have you seen each party has a definition for it? Sahih is one word. Sarfiyin, they consider sahih to mean ما خلا من حروفه أما ما خلا من بنيته حرف من حروف العلة. That the letter, the word doesn't have no defect letters in it. That's what sahih means to them. Are you with me? The opposite to that is حروف, which is معتل. أما a word which is معتل. Here, نحات mean, when they say sahih, a hadith which has conditions, which is sahih, متصل إسناده ولم يش. That's what they say. When these scholars, أصول الفقه, come and they say sahih, they mean what? ما برئ به صاحبه بذمته. No one's going to request you to come with this prayer anymore, inshallah ta'ala. You've prayed to sahih. Does that make sense? So each group of people done istilah amongst themselves. It's ta'addi, it's jawr, it's dhulm. That you take a terminology used by another science and you force it on this science. Let alone doing taqawwul on ulama statements by saying that this is what they meant. Kayf? You're taking the definition of a mutaakhirin and you're forcing it on mutaqaddimin. It's a problem that happens for many people, especially in the word makruh, karaha. The word karaha, عند المتقدمين المتأخرين, is different usages. Like when Imam Ahmed and Shafi'i and others use the word karaha, they meant what? Haram. But why did they not say haram? Why couldn't they just say it's haram? من باب الورع. Because the ayah in the Quran, what did it say? وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَةُ بِتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. They were a bit scared to say it now. Very skeptical. So they would use a word like, نَكْرَهُ ذَلِكَ. But they meant haram. Because Allah says in the Quran, after Allah said, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَمَقْتًا. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ. After all of that, what did Allah say? كُلُّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُوهًا. Makruh. All of that to Allah is makruh. But Allah is talking about zina and qatlun nafs and all of that. Are you with me? After all of that, Allah says, if kafir sayyi'u 'inda rabbika makruhan. Then when a person is using a term, don't force your understanding of what that term means or the usage of the mutaakhirin, what they understood from the term, to what it means by those people. Study the science and look at what they mean by it. Are you with me, brothers? Each fan, each field, that those people, they've agreed amongst themselves the usage of the word to be in particular things. That's what haqiqah means. The author's two definitions, both of them, when you bring them together, it makes a proper, better understanding. And I think the best definition is the last definition that he used. The last definition is much better, which is بَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. Take that definition, it's a better definition. It's more crystal clear, it's more clarified, and more... Because the haqiqah differs from... A haqiqah is not the same for everything. In one field, the haqiqah of this word is this. And in this field, the haqiqah is this. And in this field, the haqiqah... So what if I ask you, what is حَقِيقَةُ الصَّحِيحِ عِنْدَ النُّحَاتِ عِنْدَ الصَّرْفِيِّينَ? There's a meaning you're going to give me. في مصطلح علي. Does it make sense, brothers? What's the حقيقة of what the word صحيح according to the أصوليين? You give me the حقيقة of the أصوليين. لذلك, pay attention to this. The Quran, when it uses the word غلو, what's the حقيقة الغلو according to the شرع? How does the Quran look at غلو, extremism? Some people thought that the غلو, extremism, it only means exaggeration. And that is jahal of haqiqatul ghulu inda shara. The sharia doesn't look at, that's not how it sees it to mean. Ghulu means Al-ifrat wa tafriyat. Going extreme in exaggeration and also going extreme in negligence. Are you with me? Brothers, are we together? It's important. So if a person is not praying five daily prayers, is only praying three salahs, we say to him, you are an extreme person. Would the people say that today? No. The one that's got the beard, long waving beard, his scarlet, his trousers on his top, it looks like it shrinked. Very small. He's the only one who's got a big black circle on his head because of sujood. That's the one that's pointed and disgraced. And he said to him that you're extreme. Sah? So the only way, the only definition of extremism in the people's mind has become extreme in exaggeration. But no one looks at extreme to mean negligence. I'll give an example. When Allah said in the Quran, Ya Ahl al-Kitab la taghlu fi dinikum, or the people of the scripture. Who is the people of the scripture? Who Ahl al-Kitab? Al-Yahudu? Okay. Isa ibn Maryam. What did the Christians do to Isa ibn Maryam? They done ghulu to him, right? Ghulu in what, lakin? By go overboard with him. They took him out of ubudiyya and being an abd. And they gave him ibadah, they worshipped him. What did the Christians, what did the Jews do to Isa ibn Maryam? They've disbelieved in him. And they've accused his mother of what? Zina. Are you with me? Allah said to both of them, لا تغلو. Ya أهل الكتاب لا تغلو في دينكم. The ghulu here is talking to both parties. One who went extreme in exaggeration and one who went extreme in negligence. Both of them, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, Allah said to both of them, لا تغلو في دينكم. Don't go extreme into your religion. صح? So we need to understand the issue of unity again is another example. What does the Sharia understand unity to be? Don't give me your linguistic definition of the word unity. And your urfi, your custom understood, the land that you're at, what they understand to be unity. Mafhumu shara, what does it understand? What does the Sharia understand to mean unity? We have to go back to where? The Quran and the Sunnah. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa'atasimu bihablillahi jami'an wala. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, hold on to the rope of Allah and unite on it. The unity that the Sharia is speaking about, the unity according to the Sharia is based upon a correct methodology. Huh? Nowhere does the Sharia say, on falsehood all of you unite. That's your definition. Hada min kisik. It's your two cents. You don't need it now. Sharia defined the word. And it gave us an understanding of what unity means. Are you with me, brothers? That's why I think we're at a time where we should make a series called Tashihu al-Mafahim. Tashihu al-Mafahim. Take the word jihad, for example. What's understood from the word jihad? What was the mafhumu shara of the word jihad is misunderstood. Look at the word khilafa. The mafhum of khilafa has been misunderstood. Are you with me? Take the word jama'ah. Are you with me? What is the jama'ah? Oh, he opposed the jama'ah, fulan. Who was the jama'ah that I opposed? The Sharia understands the jama'ah to mean the haqq. And the people who united upon the haqq. It doesn't mean that the majority is the jama'ah. That is not the mafhumu shara. Are you with me, brothers? When those terms become, when people get distance from the kitab and the sunnah, the haqa'iq, al-shar'i, they misunderstand it. Are you with me, brothers? What made the murji'ah become misguided? Is because they defined the word iman according to the linguistic meaning and they did not give consideration to what? The shar'i meaning of the word iman. Because in the language, the word iman means at-tasdiq wa qila al-iqrar. Shaykh al-Islam Timi doesn't like the idea that it's tasdiq, he said it's iqrar. But let's just take the linguistic meaning which they believe. وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُؤْمِنٍ لَنَا وَلَوْ كُنَّا صَادِقٍ وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُصَدِّقٍ لَنَا وَلَوْ كُنَّا صَادِقٍ. That's what they mean. So they said that iman ma'anahu at-tasdiq. So whenever we read in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, it means التصديق. Say, believe in your heart, say it in your tongue, خلاص, that's Iman. No, the Sharia understands Iman to be أعمال الجوارح and أعمال القلوب. That's في حقيقة, it is part of the reality of what Iman is. Does that make sense? Without actions, your Iman doesn't exist. Do you see my point, brothers? This is where the niza' and the discussion comes. Does that make sense? Tawa'if. وَلِذَلِكَ الشَّيْخُ الْإِسْلَامِ ibn Taymiyyah said, powerful statement. He says that the groups that went against Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah and opposed Ahlul Sunnah are groups who oppose them in the understanding of the terminologies. Al-Fatih Shar'i. They became, and this topic here right now, haqiqah shar'iyyah, the haqiqah or something, we're at a time today, this government and many other governments, they'll say to you, for example, here, this is UK, you're going against British values. And you ask him, don't let it slip by. Just question him, what is British values? Arifuli. Are you with me? I want to know what the word means. British values, what does it exactly mean? Huh? Have they defined it? Is there a definition for what British values is? So since it doesn't have no definition, it can be loosely used whenever they feel like it. Are you with me, brothers? So the sirah today, pay attention. The debate, the discussions, the arguments, the khilafat, the disputes, it really is a time of terminologies. That's what I say. It's a time of terminologies, words. First definition. The second one is what it's been used, مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. When we're talking, whatever we make that term to be, so any people of any sides, whatever they determine or define a word to be, that's the haqiqah for them. So if they use that word, that the haqiqah for them is this. In the other science, according to them, is a majaz. For them, it's not haqiqah. This is the haqiqah of the word for them. But when they want to step into that science and they want to talk about that science, they have to use their definition. And the Sheikh is going to bring the different types there is. The different types is, the first one is haqiqah lughawiyyah. Some words are linguistic usage. Is a linguistic reality of it. So we use it as a linguistic usage. The Ahlul Lugha, they use it. So what was the definition that the author mentioned before about the haqiqah, the second definition? Somebody read it out quickly. What did he say? مَسْتُعْمِلَ مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ, right? Are you with me, brothers? Are we all together? Write all of that down. مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. Just add the word lisan here. In between, each definition is just one thing, you have to add there. Are you there? مِنْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ, and you add to the ending, في لغتي, في اللغة. Are you with me? And the next second one, all you add to the ending is في الشرعي. The third one, all you add to the ending is what? في العرفي. That's it. That's the three definitions. So the first one is مستعمل في مصطلح عليه من لسان المخاطبة في اللغة. The second one, which is مستعمل في مصطلح عليه من لسان المخاطبة في الشرعي. And the third one is مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ فِي الْعُرْفِ. So what does it mean, these three? What does it mean? It means the reality of words revolve around three things only. The first thing that it revolves around is حَقِيقَة, which is known as حَقِيقَة اللُّغَوِيَّة, which is مَرَدُّهُ إِلَى اللُّغَةِ. When the Qur'an says, are you with me, brothers? When the Qur'an says, اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارِ, day and night, where am I going to look for that? I'm asking you guys a question. Al-Laylu wa-Nahar wa-Shamsu wa-Al-Qamar. when the word Layl and Nahar comes, where am I going to look at the word up, Layl and Nahar? The dictionary, the Arabic language. What does midday mean? I'm not going to look for hadith that explains it to me. Are you with me? Because this is haqiqa lughawiyya. Are you with me, brothers? The second one is haqiqa shar'iyya, which is that the sharia defined what this word means. For example, the word salah, what does it linguistically mean? The word salah, linguistically, what does it mean? In the language, it means dua. Sah? So when Allah said, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayer, do I go and just beg Allah? Yeah? Are you with me, brothers? Or do I say that series that came out, the girl, she goes, I send letters to God. You guys, she said, I send letters to God. That's how she prays. Yeah? That's the haqiqah of what salah means? Sending letters to God. Do you know what I'm talking about? How you guys all do, Allahu Akbar. She sends letters to God, and God, I don't know whether he responds to her or not. She sends letters, that's what she said. No, salah is a what? أقوال وأفعال مفتتحة بالتكبير مختتمة بالتسليم. This is what it is. The Sharia now gave it a definition more different to the linguistic definition. You can't use the linguistic definition and say, no, I don't accept it. The Quran is in the Arabic language, so salah means dua in the English Arabic language, so I'm going to use that. Ya akhi, that's tahakkum. You're forcing the Sharia to follow the linguistic and the lexical meaning? No. The Sharia now came and it gave a meaning. Iman is the same, and etc. The list goes on. The third one is maradduhu. It goes back to the customs and the norms of the people. Are you there? Like when Allah says, wa'ashiruhunna, live with your wives. Where am I going to find that? In hadith? No. In the Arabic language? No. The urf is what tells me how I'm going to live nice with my wife. I'm going to go. In the land, back home in Somalia, the girl will live on $200. Nice, good. Allahu Akbar. Take care of her, $200. I'm just saying, brothers, there's always that opportunity. Yeah, if you ain't got much money, you have to get married. There's always that opportunity. $200, fine. Make it $500, the whole tribe can live on it. That's back home. Can I say the same in the UK? Yeah? The UK, yeah, her car insurance is more than that. Sah? So each place there's a ma'roof. Wa'ashiruhunna is different to each place. This is haqiqa urfiyah. I have to observe the urf and the custom. Are you with me, brothers? Some things that are okay in one country, and this is very common what we do. We do this, and it's incorrect. You're in the UK, and you travel to Saudi Arabia, or you travel to one country, and you were raised and born in this country, and there was a particular way you used to see things. So you land in one country and you automatically say, nah, this is wrong, this is right. And the urfuk, these people's urf is not like this. Are you with me, brothers? You're doing tahakkum of your urf, your customs on them. Do you have a dalil that yours is good? Do you have a dalil that you're good? You don't have a dalil for it. So each person is basing their one on their customs and their norms. Are you with me, brothers? So each custom you have to respect. As long as it doesn't go against the Sharia, brothers. You respect people's cultures. You respect them. Are you with me? And you admire when people say, this is our culture, this is how we do things. I respect the culture. As long as that culture doesn't conflate and go against, as long as it does not contradict the Sharia. If it doesn't, whatever rocks your boat. Are you with me? That's it. Mocking people's culture, mocking is actually going against the haqiqa urfiyya that they have. Are you with me, brothers? Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions the types of majaz there is. Majaz is what, first of all? It is مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي غَيْرِ مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ فِي لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَرَةِ. Just add the word غَيْر, where it says Remember you said مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُولِحَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ Just put the word فِي غَيْرِ مَسْطُولِحَ. We didn't both agree that the word أسد lion is gonna, we agreed that the word lion means a four-legged animal. You now want to use it for a courageous person. This is not what we agreed upon. So what is it that we're going to call that usage that you've just done right now? We call it majaz. Are you with me? Brothers, pay attention to this. If two people are now arguing, two people are debating, arguing. One is saying, Akhi, lion is a haywan muftaris. This is what lion means, ya rajul. Another one comes and says, la, akhi. It means rajul shuja', a brave man. And I'm the judge and I'm going to have to judge between these two. Who do I give it to? Anyone other than Imran? Hayya, Nasser. Which is which one? Which is the one who? It's the animal. Okay, exactly. That's the asal. This one's gonna be, the one who said it's a lion, we're gonna be like, you're right, by default. Can you prove wrong what he just said? He has to bring dalil. Does that make sense, brothers? And the reason why I'm mentioning this is because it's a very powerful issue, which is, some people, they will say to you, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's characteristics and attributes, Allah's sifat. They'll say Allah has a hand. خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ. The Arabs have used the word yad to mean quwwah. Strength, power. Are you with me, brothers? According to the Arabic language, what does the word yad mean? It means a hand, right? Somebody now comes and says, no, it means ability, strength, and power. Are you all with me? You've now come to a verse that says, yad, Allah's hand. You've taken it from its haqiqi usage, and you've taken it to a majazi usage. Give me a qareena. That's the question I ask. Where's the qareena? Because if a person comes up to me without a qareena, just says, I saw a lion, I'm going to take it as the haywan al-muftaris. Unless he puts a qareena in the context. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? So that's why I say, that, is there majaz in the Qur'an? Yes, there is majaz in the Qur'an. Shaykh al-Islam Taymi doesn't allow that. Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti doesn't allow it. It's allowed. It is in the Qur'an. Are you with me? But with the condition that I mentioned. The majaz is a what? It's not the original default position. If you want to turn away from the default position and the asl, bring your dalil and evidence for why you're saying that yad here doesn't mean hand. That it means what? Are you with me? Then he'll say to you, because if I say it, this is his qareena now. He's going to say, if I say hand, it's going to mean that I'm trying to say Allah has the human hand. I'm saying this is not a qareena in the language. Are you there? And I'll tell you why it's not a qareena. The clock, what do you say? The hand of the clock, right? What do you say about me? Hand. The hand, it's haqiqa. For each person's, the way it looks is different. I'm sure my hand doesn't look like a clock hand. Yeah? You affirm it, you say the clock of the hand. But the way it looks for the clock is different from the way it looks for me. But we share the name. That's the same from us and Allah. Are you with me? Simple, easy. So this is what it is. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he divided the majaz into four. He says, al-majaz bi-ziyada, al-majaz bi-nuqsan, and al-majaz bi-naqli, and al-majaz bi-isti'ara. Brothers, we'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. Saturday now. Saturday, inshallah ta'ala, we'll start at 7, and we'll carry on up to 7.